Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In alhamdulillahi nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah wa man yudlil fala hadiya lah. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu. Sallallahu ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin amma ba'd. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinaba. Amin ya rabbal alamin. So welcome to the ICNA Dawah conference. ICNA is the conference title is Islam, the solution in times of confusion. Our next speaker, just jumping right into the next speaker, inshallah, is Dr. Suzy Ismail. Just to introduce Dr. Suzy, subhanAllah, I mean, another, you know, I don't know how many hats these Muslim brothers and sisters have in the deen, but inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward them tremendously. Dr. Suzy is the founder of the Head Communication and Head Communication Counselor at Cornerstone. You know, it's a faith-based communication counseling center. Dr. Suzy has been speaking, traveling the world, helping and guiding brothers and sisters here in the West, also in, you know, places that is needed in the Middle East and other places. Dr. Suzy has written books, and you know, I have her book. Inshallah, one day I'll get her to autograph one of her books, inshallah, for me. Without further ado, inshallah, I'll give the floor to Dr. Suzy.
جزاك الله خير بدر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمد ونشكر ونستعين ونستغفر ونتوب إليه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد محمد عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم everyone and good afternoon or good morning wherever you may be. Good evening. I know that we have people joining us from all different parts of the world. So you know, may Allah عز وجل bless ICNA and Why Islam for putting together this conference and gathering us in this gathering, despite it being virtual, but still feeling like we can connect with one another in this way. So the topic that I wanted to speak about that I've been working quite closely with Why Islam on for the past year or so has to do with education, and particularly our public school systems and how our children are responding to what they experience in the school system. And I think currently, knowing that we are seeing so many different forms of education, whether it's virtual or it's hybrid, or many parents choosing the option of removing their children from school systems and opting for different homeschooling curricula instead, we're seeing a major shift in the paradigm of how schooling occurs. But even within that shift, the reality is that, you know, our children, as the Imam was speaking about earlier, are still very much like that tree that Imam was describing, the tree that is referenced in the Quran, that good tree, that the foundations that we give our children, the foundations in terms of, you know, what they're experiencing in school, in their upbringing, in terms of how they're you know, going through this COVID pandemic and the response that their school may be having is going to affect them in a very large way as well. So what we've been doing over the past year, year and a half with Why Islam is really trying to reach those who are the administrators, those who are the educators, those who are really involved in doing that learning and that education, providing that learning and that education for our children, particularly at the public school level. Last year, last November actually, Why Islam hosted a session at the NJEA, which is the New Jersey Education Association Conference. It's a conference that is attended by thousands of public school teachers, administrators, staff, and others every year. And in that program, Why Islam hosted a session in which I had presented about socio-emotional wellness and how do we ensure that sense of inclusivity for children of all faith backgrounds, for children of all cultures, of all races. And there was also a wonderful booth in which Why Islam was handing out Qurans and literature about Islam. And I know I had gone to visit the booth before my session, and mashallah, all of the Qurans that were there had already been handed out. And you could see the interest interest. And I think part of the work that we do in Dawah sometimes feels like, you know, we're grinding and wondering, like, are we reaching anyone? Are we connecting with anyone? I had seen in the comments earlier, somebody was asking about the public sphere and how do we as a Muslim ummah, for example, in the United States of America, how do we insert ourselves to have influence to be able to affect change, even in the political level? And I see our children, I see the coming generations as being essentially those trees that inshallah will grow and will be able to effect that change as long as we are there laying the foundation down and guiding those who are teaching them towards the best way to reach them. And ICNA and Why Islam is going to continue this journey in terms of outreach for public schools and really building that sense of inclusivity through different webinars, online programs that will be offered to different public school teachers. Islamic school teachers, I believe, are also welcome to attend, but really focusing on socio-emotional wellness, particularly in the current educational climate, and how do we ensure that all of our children are included. And I believe we will start that first online session next week or within the next 2 weeks or so. So look out for information on that so that you can invite maybe your public school teachers and invite those who teach your children directly as well. So, you know, when we look at what's happening in the school system, I want to go back to some data that was collected over the past year, the, you know, 2018-2019 year, and it was collected by the Institute for Social Policy and Understanding. And the statistics that we see there is very eye-opening, and I think we can translate it into what we're seeing today, even in the virtual education environment as well. So according to the data from 2019, we see that 62% of Muslims in the prior year reported that they had experienced discrimination based on their faith. And this is, you know, adults and children. We're not just talking about, you know, just the adults, but also the impact that the adults, the feeling of discrimination that the adults experience, the impact it would have on their children. We see that 38% of Muslims, and this is all in the US, 38% of Muslims in the US over the past year feared for their safety following the 2016 election. Now, for those of you who are here in the US, you know that this is another election year, and that come November, there's, you know, the parties that are looking for change and parties that are not looking for change. And we need to anticipate the impact that even this election year will have on our children and on our families here in the US. We see that 42% of Muslim children over the past year experienced bullying due to their religion. That's 42%. That means if you had, you know, it's almost like one out of every two Muslims experienced bullying in school. And these are Muslim children between kindergarten and 12th grade. We see that 67% of those bullies were students, but 19% of those who reported being bullied said they were bullied by both students and teachers or administrators. This is a problem. If our educators are, you know, many times inadvertently, you know, partaking in the making our children feel uncomfortable in the schoolroom, making them feel like they are not safe, this is a problem. And of course, it is anxiety inducing and can lead to many other difficulties as well. We also see that 85% of Muslims identify that their faith is a source of happiness. And this statistic I thought was very beautiful because it tells us that, again, adults or children, that faith is an important component. And because that faith is an important component, we want to be able to incorporate that sense of spiritual well-being, just like we incorporate emotional well-being, physical well-being, and academic well-being into the school systems. So what are we seeing today in the virtual world and what our children are experiencing? Bullying is still happening. I don't want any of us, whether we're parents or educators or community members, thinking that our children, because they're home, they are now safe. We are seeing some of the worst incidences of cyberbullying occurring today because of the virtual environment. And we're seeing it happening. For example, you know, recently we had a child who was really struggling emotionally because you know, someone in the Zoom classroom had taken a picture of them, a screenshot of them, had photoshopped it, and that picture was circulated circulating among the students. So we're seeing incidences of cyberbullying, and it's reminiscent, you know, some of you may be familiar with a show that had come out a few years ago called 13 Reasons Why, in which a teenager takes her own life, commits suicide, and her downfall, essentially the bullying, began with a picture of her being circulated that wound up growing and growing and leading to other difficulties. So as educators, as parents, as family members, know the dangers that our children may be exposed to even in this virtual environment. We also see difficulties in terms of social inequities, children comparing where they're studying now. You know, it used to be children would physically go to school and school was somewhat of an equalizer. They were all in the same classroom. If the school mandated uniforms, they were all dressed similarly. But now we're seeing on the Zoom classrooms, children showing, you know, their bedrooms, seeing what's behind them. Children who are unable to have access to their own study space, having to be cramped, you know, children taking classes from a closet because there's no other space in the home, children whose parents are fighting, children in situations where there may be domestic violence occurring and no longer having that escape, that ability to leave and to go to school. So I know we're moving a bit quickly here and that there's a lot that's going to be covered by other speakers as well. But I think, you know, one of the pleas that I would put out there in getting involved in the ICNA outreach programs, in attending the programs that we'll be setting up for teachers, in inviting others to attend, something that Imam Rafiq had mentioned, the importance of compassion, because our children need compassion now more than ever before. We as parents need compassion as well. We as educators need compassion as well. And that compassion has to come in the form of understanding. Understanding the statistics and what our children have faced when they were physically attending school and what they're facing now in the virtual environment. Understanding that there is a huge change and that change is impacting our children and that we don't know yet what the long-term effects are going to be on our kids of the pandemic, of the virtual learning environment, of not having that access to the social interactions that they may have once had, and we're still learning. So I would ask that all of us, you know, as community members, as educators, as parents, to take a step back at this time and to really think about, you know, what's my child experiencing? What's my neighbor's child experiencing? What's my niece, my nephew? You know, what are the children around us experiencing? You know, when we look to our Muslim children, for example, in the school system, are they facing difficulty because of social inequity, because of homes that may look different, because of interactions that may spur bullying? And how can we show that compassion? And how can we as a community also help one another? Because I think that's a huge part of compassion and empathy, is being able to stand side by side and not point fingers, not think like, wow, this parent is not really helping the child with the online schooling. This parent may be juggling two or three or four jobs trying to just stay afloat. You know, this parent may be struggling with other children. So having that sense of compassion, having that ability to understand one another, to recognize, for example, traditionally teachers were taught to use the VARC methodology, you know, visual, oral, reading and kinesthetic, and to understand that children learn differently. Yet now we're teaching online and we're teaching almost in what sometimes feels like a one size has to fit all, because we can't offer the child who learns kinesthetically that kinesthetic option. So I think just to bring it back to that sense of compassion and that ability to understand and to educate ourselves on how we can educate our children. You know, we go back to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, who his interactions with children leave us so much that we can learn from. You know, from speaking to Zayd radiallahu anhu when he had the bird Umayr when he was a child, and how the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, showed such empathy when that bird passed away. So understand our children's anxiety, understand what they may be going through right now in the virtual learning environment, and join us, inshallah, in the Why Islam ICNA sessions that will be happening, designed for teachers. Look out for them, bi'iznillah. They'll begin within 2 weeks, inshallah.
Thank you. Jazakallah khair. Barakallahu laki. Thank you so much. So, alhamdulillah, we have Dr. Suzy. I wanted to we have a question here for you. Is that what is your advice for people that are being bullied? And like, how do they not only overcome that bullying, but enable them to be able to help others that are in that situation?
All right. Assalamu alaikum, everyone, again. So for whoever asked that question, I think it's a wonderful question, and it shows that we are taking steps towards awareness, recognizing that bullying does exist, validating the child and allowing the child to see that. And again, whether it's a child or a teen or even an adult that's experiencing bullying at work or with colleagues, we see this consistently. So first of all, identifying that absolutely bullying exists, and it takes many different shapes and forms. Validate it, understand it's there, recognize the effects of it on the person, then take those steps to remedy it. Meaning, it is not okay for us to tell our children, it's okay, just ignore the bully and then they'll stop. Because that's not how our deen has taught us to act upon oppression. We know that bullying is a form of oppression, and Rasulullah ﷺ guided us to stop oppression and to stop it by stopping the hand of the oppressor. Meaning, take those steps. Go to the principal if this is a school bullying situation. Speak to CARE. I mean, CARE is a wonderful organization that helps in a lot of cases in which there is discrimination in the school system or in the workplace. Identify who is in those roles of higher ups and take those steps. Because when we talk about having tawakkul, having sabr, having that trust in Allah Azza wa Jal, it doesn't mean for us to, you know, just sit back and just say, you know, oh Allah, please remove this hardship. It means we do make that dua, oh Allah, remove this hardship, but we also ask, what am I doing to help remove it? So take every step that you can to identify the path. And if you are not reaching the level that you need to stop this bullying for the child or for the adult even, by following that traditional path, seek that help elsewhere. Reach out to ICNA, reach out to other places as well.
JazakAllah khair, and barakallahu lakum, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.